We just finished a three-week sermon series in the Old Testament book of Jonah. In that series, I was reminded how much I can relate to Jonah. I wish I could say otherwise, since it's his selfish traits that resonated with me. His resistance to obey, guilty. His stubbornness, guilty. His complaining, guilty. His anger, guilty. He's often called the reluctant prophet, which rings true with me too. You know, I'm glad that the Bible has real, grungy, messed up people like me that God still uses for his purposes. Aren't you glad? It's encouraging, isn't it, that God uses us in spite of ourselves. To be honest, I felt like Jonah when I was working on this sermon. I'm what you could say a reluctant preacher. I didn't run away, but I fought with God, lost sleep, pushed it off, procrastinated, complained, all my usual stubborn strategies for coping. I was overwhelmed by it. I just didn't want to do it. And I'm not even preaching to Ninevites. So that's a little peek behind the curtain to my connection with Jonah, but not what I really want to preach about today. So let's get to that. Well, it's the first week in February, so guess what I'm preaching about today? Did you say love? Well, if you did, then you're right. Why is it that we think about love in February? I can tell you why I think about love. My wife's birthday is February 1st. She is the love of my life. She's the best example of love that I know. Now, it may be difficult to believe this, but I'm not always easy to love. And I'm not as good at loving her as I should be, but I want to keep getting better. Emily was born on the first day of February, so that's my reason to love this month. But that's not why February is the month of love. So what is it then? Well, it's Valentine's Day, right? February 14th, which is right around the corner, guys. It's a holiday for celebrating love with candy and flowers and teddy bears and, well, Valentine's, those special cards with messages like, "Be mine." If God sent a Valentine to you, I think it would say, "Be mine." He created us to know him and worship him and be in a loving relationship with him. So his Valentine to you is "Be mine." Just for fun, here are some Valentines from kids. Roses are red, violets are blue. You are my brother and a knucklehead too. Mom and Dad, you are lucky you're still alive. I love you very much. This one is a setup from a teacher with a fill in the blank. Mom, I love you more than rainbows and beautiful blue skies. I love you more than buttercups and wings of butterflies. I love you more than cow. Wow, that might be the greatest measure of love I've ever heard. As a school bus driver, I like this one. Dear Mom, I love you. You're doing a good job at not burping at my bus stop. And finally, for the workout enthusiast, happy Valentine's Day, sweaty. Hey, if it's true, call it like it is. Okay, enough Valentine's Day. Let's talk about love. It's a word that is used a lot. It's the answer that is given as a solution to so many problems, and rightly so. We need more love. Choose love is one of the messages that NFL players have on their helmets. The Beatles sang, "All you need is love." Although, Dwight Schrute from The Office disagrees. Anyone familiar with Dwight? Any fans of The Office? I'm not sure if this is from an actual episode of the show, but it's become a meme anyway. Dwight Schrute protests, "Love is all you need? False. The four basic human necessities are air, water, food, and shelter." Put that on a Valentine. Oh, look, someone did. Okay, now we're done with Valentine's Day. Everyone seems to agree that loving each other is a good thing. But what does it mean to love? It's easy to say just love. Love everyone, always, as a blanket fix-all. But it's much harder to know how to love, especially when we live in a world that is flawed and full of sinners. Our culture confuses love. It treats love as a feeling that we fall into and fall out of. But love is more than a feeling. That's the song that Emily and I had played on our wedding day, More Than a Feeling by Boston, as we walked out hand in hand after the ceremony. Love is more than a feeling. Our culture confuses love. It tells us that love means affirmation. Even if someone is wrong, our culture says that the best way to love them is to agree with their truth. I like this quote from Pastor Rick Warren. He says, "Our culture has accepted two huge lies. The first is that if you disagree with someone's lifestyle, you must fear or hate them. The second is that to love someone means you agree with everything they believe or do. Both lies are nonsense. You don't have to compromise convictions to be compassionate." The world confuses love because it rejects God, shuts him out. Everyone wants their own truth. They want to be their own authority. But in order to talk about love, we need a footing, a foundation. We need an authority. We need truth. And that's Jesus. He said, "I am the way and the truth and the life." Sure, anyone can say those things. If you said them, well, I'd think you're a liar or a lunatic. But Jesus backed up all of his claims by predicting his own suffering, his death, and resurrection, and then pulling it off with plenty of historical evidence to boot. No one else has done that. He is the one true living God. So Jesus is the ultimate authority, our source of truth, and our starting point on love. Love is a primary theme throughout the Bible. The Bible reveals a loving God who loves to love because he is love and he loves all. I was curious how many times the word love is mentioned in the Bible. What I found is it depends on the Bible. According to the King James Version, it's 310 times. Then, when the King James Bible was updated to the New King James Version, the number changed to 361. In the English Standard Version, love is mentioned 551 times, and 645 in the New Living Translation. So why the difference? Well, it's because of the English language and because of the translations. You see, the English language is not very precise in descriptions. For example, I could say, "I love my wife, I love Da Bears, and I love Meat Lover's Pizza." But I don't love Da Bears the same way I love my wife. And I definitely don't love pizza as I love her. In English, we use the word love to describe a wide variety of different feelings and relationships. It carries a lot of weight for one little word. But the original languages of the Bible, ancient Hebrew and Greek, are much more precise when describing love. Greek, for example, has four different words for love, depending on the situation. Is it friendship love? Is it family love? Is it romantic, intimate love? Is it unconditional love? There are different words for each. But more important than how many times the word love appears in the Bible is what does the Bible teach us about love? The most well-known Bible verse is all about God's love, John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." It's a verse that perfectly describes how God's love is demonstrated by sacrifice. His love acts on our behalf for our good, our best interest. It's not just a warm, fuzzy feeling or emotion. Jesus died so that we could have life. That's love in action. That's sacrificial love. John, the guy who wrote 3:16, was one of Jesus' disciples and closest friends. He referred to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved, and he wrote more about love. I just want to take you on a tour of a few verses that John wrote. 13:34, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. John 15:13, greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. 1 John 3:1, how great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. 1 John 3:16, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. 1 John 3:18, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and in truth. This then is how we know that we belong to the truth. 1 John 4:10, this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. 1 John 4:12, no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. Simply put, God is love. 1 John 4:16. When Jesus was tested by an expert in the law, which is the greatest commandment? He replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. Sounds simple, right? Well, yeah, let's keep it simple. But let's unpack it some more, especially as love relates to truth. How do we balance truth and love in today's hostile environment? Let me ask you, have you ever felt you have to choose between showing people kindness or telling them something you know they may not like? To put it a different way, have you ever felt you had to choose between truth and love? Should I love my friend and ignore the truth? Or should I stand on the truth and reject my friend? There's a tension. How do we balance truth and love? Pastor encouraged us last week to love all people, just like God does. Love our enemies. Love the wicked and pray for them. Have a heart for them to be saved. If we truly love people, we will want them to be saved. If we truly love them, we will speak the truth in love, to have difficult conversations, to help those stuck in sin, to share the gospel, to share our own struggles, to show humility, not self-righteousness, because we are all beggars, telling other beggars where to find bread. The Apostle Paul said some things about this idea of truth and love in a letter which still rings true today. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13, he writes, be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. He's saying, cling to the truth. Be bold. Don't waffle. But he doesn't leave it there. The next verse, he says, do everything in love. Everything we do has to be wrapped in love. In Christ, we don't have to choose between truth and love. With Jesus, truth and love go together like peanut butter and jelly. They go hand in hand. Truth is the foundation for love, and love is the visible expression of truth. Well, if you don't like PB&J, think of it like a burrito. You got to have the stuff on the inside, you know, the meat, the rice, salsa, beans, cheese, guac, whatever you want to put in it. But it's not a burrito unless you wrap it up. So whatever we're doing, it has to be wrapped in love. My kids love it when I turn them into burritos. I lay a big blanket on the floor, and I have them lay down on one end of it. Then I roll them up like a burrito, and I lift it up to eat it. Well, this past Christmas, we had the youth group over to our house for a party, and we did a white elephant gift exchange. My kids participated too. And look what one of them got as a gift. It's a round tortilla blanket, perfect for making my favorite burritos. I can wrap them up in there and then eat them. Whenever you think of burritos, I want you to think about wrapping the truth in love. Here's why. Because telling people the truth is actually one of the most loving things you can do for them. But don't take my word for it. One of the wisest men that ever lived, even wiser than Gandalf, his name was Solomon. And he said in his book of Proverbs 27:6, he said, "Wounds from a sincere friend are better than many kisses from an enemy." Another translation reads, "Wounds from a friend can be trusted, but an enemy multiplies kisses." What he's saying is that when you hear the truth from a friend, and it stings a little bit, it cuts a bit, but it's the truth. That's far better than flattery, far better than just hearing what you want to hear, because the bottom line is that the truth is the foundation from which love flourishes. We can't have truth without love, and we're not really loving people if we're not telling them the truth. Wouldn't you want to be told the truth? Well, maybe not always. I recently went to the dentist, and he told me that I have a cavity. I don't want to hear that, but I need to hear that. He didn't just tell me and send me off, though. I made another appointment for him to take care of it for me, to fix the problem, to fill in the cavity. The truth brings freedom, purpose, and life, but lies bring bondage, confusion, and death. Jesus said the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. Do you know how the thief steals, kills, and destroys? With lies. Look at this about the devil. Jesus says he was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Lies are powerful. It makes me think of a book series that I read to my kids. It's called The Wing Feather Saga by Andrew Peterson. In the story, there's a ruthless tyrant called Nag the Nameless. He's taking over the world with his army of venomous fangs, these brutal creatures that are part human, part lizard. The fangs kidnap children and take them away in a black carriage to turn them into more fangs. As the story goes on, we learn that Nag the Nameless, as wicked as he is, and as much harm and terror that he has inflicted, is himself the victim of terrible lies. His whole life, he was raised in seclusion and told that his family, his own mother, didn't love him, that she discarded him and never even named him. It fueled his hate. But in truth, his mother loved him deeply and did give him a name. He just didn't know it. She was lied to as well. She was told that her son didn't survive because of birth complications, so she didn't even know that he was alive. The one behind all the lies was, in fact, jealous of the family. So he hatched this plan full of lies that led to so much death and destruction. It's a wonderful story of adventure and suspense and redemption. The ending is powerful. I don't want to give too much away. You'll have to check it out for yourself. They're currently turning the Wing Feather Saga into an animated series that's available on the Angel Studios app, along with The Chosen. The Wing Feather Saga tells the long-reaching and devastating effects of lies. However, there's something even more powerful and more transformational than lies. That's the truth, the gospel truth. It's needed today more than ever. I'm not going to lie to you. Telling the truth may cost you something. You might be misunderstood. You may be labeled, called names. Your friends might turn their backs on you because you follow God's ways. You might lose your job. Jesus said, "Don't be surprised if the world hates you. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first." Love is being committed to the best of another person regardless of how they feel, even if they hate you for it. I saw this on display by actress Candace Cameron Bure, an outspoken Christian who received backlash after her decision to work with networks and filmmakers who reflect biblical marriage between a man and a woman. She responded to her detractors with this on her Instagram. She said, "I'm a devoted Christian, which means that I believe that every human being bears the image of God. Because of that, I am called to love all people, and I do. If you know me, you know that I am a person who loves fiercely and indiscriminately. My heart yearns to build bridges and to bring people one step closer to God, to love others as well, and to simply be a reflection of God's huge love for us all." Bure continued, "To those who hate what I value and who are attacking me online, I love you. To those who have tried to assassinate my character, I love you. To everyone reading this of any race, creed, sexuality, or political party, including those who have tried to bully me with name-calling, I love you." What a great and gracious response. Okay, but that's not always our gut response, right? So let's ask a challenging question here. Why are Christians today often seen as unloving and not respectful to people who don't believe what we believe? Why is that our reputation out there in the world? Well, I think there are two main reasons why. The first deals with unbelievers, and the second deals with us as believers. The first reason is that the world doesn't always want the truth. Our world wants to be affirmed, not questioned. For the most part, we all do. No one says, "Hey, I want you to examine everything I say and do and tell me if my actions line up." Think about it. Not many of us ask for that. So when it comes to someone who isn't even a believer, hearing truth from a believer, we can come across as harsh. But that doesn't mean we should stop telling the truth. Remember, truth and love is like a burrito. We have to have the truth on the inside, wrapped in love. This leads to the second reason as to why Christians are looked at as intolerant. The second reason is that believers, as believers, we don't always do things in love. We have to admit that. When Christians have tried to show people the truth, we sometimes do it in an unloving way. Think about it this way. Have you ever had that moment when you told an annoying sibling something that was the truth, but you said it in a way that you knew they wouldn't like? You know, pushing their buttons or drudging up the past or sticking it to them or reveling in their guilt, even enjoying their pain like they deserve it, you know? We can tell the truth in that moment, but how we're going about it isn't wrapped in love. Here's why this matters. Because truth without love is harsh. When we swing around the truth with no love, we hurt people and we get a bad reputation. We must show people we care about them with the love and truth of the gospel. Author and pastor Timothy Keller wrote, "Love without truth is sentimentality. It supports and affirms us, but it keeps us in denial about our flaws. And truth without love is harshness. It gives us information, but in such a way that we cannot really hear it. There's no better way to show love with truth than through action. Because love can't just be what we say. It has to be how we live." 1 John 3:18 says, "Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth." He's saying that love is not just with our mouths. We can't just say we love people but not treat them well. We can't say we love people when our actions don't back it up. So how do we do this? How do we go about loving people the right way while remaining in truth? We do it in two ways. First, we stay close to people. It's easy not to care when you're not close with people. Get in a habit of befriending people, making sure they belong, even before they believe what we believe. The second is to stay persistent. Don't give up on someone after sharing Jesus with them one time. Build friendships with Christians and non-Christians alike, and look for ways throughout the relationship to walk in love and also live out truth. The bottom line is you don't have to choose between the truth of the Bible and the love of Christ. Decide today to stand firmly in the truth of God's word and to commit to love those around you with that truth. God's saving love in Christ is marked by both radical truthfulness about who we are and yet also radical, unconditional, loving commitment to us. His merciful commitment strengthens us to see the truth about ourselves and to repent. Our conviction and repentance moves us to cling to and rest in God's mercy and grace. God loves us beyond what we deserve. With Him, truth and love aren't opposing forces. They're two sides of the same coin. You can't have one without the other. Truth wrapped in love. Anyone hungry for a burrito? Let's pray. God, you are love and you are truth. We believe it. We ask you to live in us, to grow in us, to work through us, to bring your love and your truth to others today. Make us into people that are known for our love because we're so full of your love. All this we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.
To the stairs I am with thy one plea, burden that thy blood was shed for me, and then thou biddest me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. To the stairs I am and waiting now to rid my soul of one dark God, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. To the stairs I am, though tossed about, with many a conflict bend me down, fightings and fears within, without a Tuesdays I am that weary sea. We'll welcome God to cleanse, relieve, because I promise I believe, oh Lamb of God, I come, I come.
Well, good morning, church. Gene here, one of the elders of the church. And I'd just like to ask you to join me in prayer this chilly morning. And we just want to pray to the Lord. Father God, we come to you this morning just recognizing what a mighty loving God you are and how you are training us up to emulate you, to copy you and how that love works. And we thank you for that message that we are to love one another. Lord, we're still figuring out how best to do that. It's not easy in this world today, Lord, to love on some people, to love on our enemies, and to love on each other, because we have so many differences. And the demon, Lord, has stepped it up, as you know, and is dividing people as much as he can and keeping people in fear. And that has nothing to do with love. If we can bring love into that, we can break all these chains. Yeah. Just thank you, Lord, for a warm church to be in. We thank you for a wonderful, wonderful message from Brian that you are all powerful and all loving, God, no matter what. And you are a rock. We can rely on that. And let us figure out as your followers how best to do that with others. Continue to grow us up, Lord, and make us the mighty army that you need to combat all the anger and fear in this world, that we might bring love to it and expand on it. Be with us today, Lord, throughout the next week, that we might practice this in all that we do and honor you in all that we do. We love you, God. Amen.